Peace, Mike Geronimo, right here, Report Card Radio, with my guy, Biggest in Charge, Mikey T, the superstar. We here, y'all.
All right, so we're going to go into something else here that I hope you can give me some insight on, being a lyrical genius yourself, being a music guy, man. What did you end up thinking of Jay-Z and Nas going at each other, man? How did it feel to live through that?
It's kind of weird. You know, it's kind of weird. I mean, from my standpoint, it was weird because I have love for both of them, you know, and Nas is pretty much from the hood. And, you know, Hov is pretty much my people that, you know, I rock with because we family through this connection. So it was very awkward, to say the least, you know, but they were two grizzly bears. What are you going to do? You going to get in the middle of two grizzly bears fighting? No. You know, so you let the grizzly bears do what they do and get it out their system, and you, I guess, hope for the best. And that was pretty much it. You know, I think now that we're able to be in a place where we're so far removed from that period, like, now you can look at it and you can see, you know, some of the good things that came from it inadvertently. But no, was it pleasant to watch or an experience? No, not at all. Not at all.
Did you ever see it coming, and did it really separate New York?
I don't know that it separated New York. I don't think that it did that. Did I see it coming? I don't know that I saw it coming, but I don't think I was terribly surprised when it did happen. But it forced, I guess, people in New York to choose the red pill or the blue pill, in a sense, you know. So I don't think it divided New York. I just think it was a matter of what your taste buds requested and what you dug more, and whichever one of those MCs embodied more of what you dug, that's who you chose, that's who you ran with. But I mean, it was a hell of a battle. It was like Ali and Frazier all over again.
Yeah, a lot of people like to say shit about Nas eventually signing to Jay-Z later on. But if Jay's able to give him a platform that he really needs, you know, no, I don't see anything wrong with it.
I mean, but, you know, I say it all the time. People are always going to say something. And usually they say more when they know less, which is so, I mean, people are going to always say something. But in the end, I mean, in the end, it turned out great.
Icons.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, to see the businessman that Jay's become, and, you know, Nas as well with his investments. Yeah, the investments that he's fortunate enough to have made, and you know, congratulations to him and Hit-Boy for the Grammy that, you know, for years he deserved to get one, and he finally got one.
Right.
So I think all in all, if you look at the whole picture, maybe it's just the period of time that was required to get to this masterpiece that we all get to see now. So, yeah, I look at it that way. I look at it that way. I don't at all look at it like, oh, well, Nas lost and then Hov signed and then, yeah, okay, but I mean, they both ate together, and that's actually testament to two people being able to be men enough to put their differences aside, which were very considerable personal differences, and they found a way to work together, and that's amazing. That's what people should give credit to.
Can we talk about DMX for a minute, man?
Yeah, we could talk about it.
I want to speak on one of the greatest artists to ever touch a mic, to ever sell a record. You know, to me, DMX is one of the most inspirational artists to ever exist.
Agreed. My kids right now, funny enough, my youngest son, who's 5, is actually in my living room now because he discovered the best of DMX on Music Choice last night. So he's watching it again in the living room.
Yeah, I actually first listened to DMX when I was 10 years old in 1998, you know.
Wow.
I was born in 88, so his albums had come out in 98, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I always tell my followers, my listeners, I really got into music like right after Pac and Big passed, because I was really only like 7, 8 years old in 95, 96. I wasn't really all the way there. You know, I was a little kid.
Right. You still, I get it.
Putting together toy guns with Legos and shit like that. You know what I mean? But yo, what's something about DMX that you will never forget, Mike?
Oh, man, bro. There's so much, Mike. You know, there's so much. It's like, I remember we were in Boomer. He had a low rider called Boomer. Boomer was his dog that passed away. And he had this white low rider and he had Boomer airbrushed on. It was either the trunk or the hood. I want to say the trunk. And we were in the city. I don't even know what happened, but he called me, whatever. He came and he got me from somewhere. And he's just driving like a madman through the city, which if you knew X, he drove like a madman, like all the time. And my brother was trying to follow behind us in his car. So we were in like a parking lot. And it had one of those like gates that lifts up to let the cars out. And my brother's in a truck behind us. And like X is flying towards the barricade thing. And at first I'm like, nah, there's no way he won't. He is. He's going, oh my God, shit. So he drove under it. But we cleared it. And my brother's truck could not clear it. And my brother calls me like 2 minutes later, cursing up the storm. He's like, yo, I'm fucking mad. I'm going to kill him. Yo, I almost lost the front of my car trying to keep up with y'all. So me and Eggs like start talking. And we always, like, we could always talk in a way that wouldn't bother each of us. Like, he could say something to me that, you know, maybe somebody else might piss me off saying, but we just had that thing. And forget how I got to it. But I was just like, yo, man, you don't care enough. And he just looks at me while he's driving. He's like, dog, you care too much. And I was like, and I just did one of these. And I was like, this sums up the nature of our relationship. You know, like, he's the yin and I'm the yang. And that's, but it's funny because as I got older and things would come about in my own life that maybe it's like, you know, maybe you want to take this risk. Maybe taking this risk will lead you to something better. So when those moments would arise in life, I would always go back to hearing him say, well, you know what, dog, you care too much. And so that's one of the things that I'm going to always give credit to him for, because he was definitely one of the first people in life with me to make me understand the importance of just letting go and just doing and not worrying, but just go and do, you know, and or even when we would record, remember he would just be like, everything with you, my G, it gotta be four bars, dog. Da-da-da-da-da, boom. Then again, da-da-da-da-da, boom. You're in, dog, you're out, dog. It's gotta be beautiful. And just those things, you know, so I'd be lying if I said it doesn't hurt. hurts a lot. That hurts a lot. But I'm so glad that I got the time with him. And I'm so glad that I'm so glad that I could say in the end that I'm very glad that that was a friend I met in life. Very glad. You know, so I miss him tremendously. I'm always miss him because you don't really get to find people in hip hop that you can say to yourself, if I wasn't doing music or not, I would still be chilling with this person every day. And that's X. And that's, he's gonna always be that to me. You know, so I miss him very much.